Beware Shadows in the Night. Chapter 6. The train raced through the dark tunnel, taking me farther and farther away from Luna. I thought how frightened she must be, and then I realized my heart was beating fast. I was scared, too. I wanted to ask someone for help, but I wasn't sure who to ask. I decided to take a chance and ask the man standing closest to me. I tapped him on the shoulder. He turned around and frowned at me. A gray hat covered one eye and cast a shadow on his face. "What do you want, kid?" he growled in a mean voice. I tried to stay calm, but my words got all mixed up. I was wondering how to get off the subway," I said. I mean, when to get off? I mean, if I should get off?" He squinted his beady eyes at me. "Listen, pipsqueak," he said. "I don't know where you're from, but it sure ain't here. It's not hard. The door's open, you get out. End of story." Well, that was clear. It wasn't nice, but it was clear. The minute the doors opened, I grabbed my snack and scoot and dashed out of the train. I was in another station that looked a lot like the one we had just left. "Hey, little soldier," a voice said. "I like your jeep. I've never seen a pink two-wheeler before." It was a man in an army uniform. He looked like this picture we have of my grandpa when he was in the army. He even had a bunch of medals on his chest. "You AWOL?" he asked me. "I might be," I said, "if I knew what that meant." "Army talk," he said. "It means absent without leave. You know, like when you sneak away without permission." "Oh, then I definitely am," I said. "I'm looking for my friend. She's AWOL, too, and I need to get back to the station that I just came from." "Easy as pie. You go over there, across those tracks," he said. "Good luck." I put my hand up to my forehead and saluted. I saw that in a movie once. The soldier laughed, and he saluted back. He seemed so nice. I hoped he was going to be safe in the war. I had to wait almost 5 minutes for the train. I checked the clock on the subway wall. We had already used up 17 minutes of the hour of power, and we hadn't even come close to finding David yet. The F train pulled up, and I got on. When the doors opened at the next stop, I jumped off. I raced to the southbound platform. There was no Luna in sight. Panicked, I shouted her name, which echoed across the station. "Luna," I called. "Luna, are you here?" There was no answer, only a strange, terrible moan, like a donkey with a bad stomach ache. What was that sound? And where is Luna? I thought. My eyes darted around the station. I could feel the minutes slipping away. Over in a corner, I noticed a small crowd had gathered. I caught a glimpse of something red in the middle of it, and I bolted across the station and pushed my way through the people. There in the middle of the crowd was Luna. Sitting on a chair next to her was a man with a saw between his knees. A real saw, the kind you saw wood with. He held the end of it with one hand, and with the other one he pulled a violin bow across the saw's jagged edge. So that was where the awful noise was coming from. "Tiger," Luna called out when she saw me. The man stopped playing. Luna threw her arms around me, the kind of hug I call the Luna Special. Normally, I'm not a big fan of the Luna Special, but if it kept that man from playing his saw, I was all for it. "I've been calling for you," I told her. "Well, it's hard to hear anything over Sammy's playing," she said. "Tiger, this is my new friend, Sammy Sampson. He invented the singing saw. Isn't it great?"
"The greatest," I lied.
I never would have told him the truth, that if I heard one more note from his saw, my ears would jump off my head and run away to the North Pole. I know that when you invent something, it really hurts your feelings if people don't like it. "You're not going to believe this. Sammy lives on Essex Street. It's his neighborhood." "When you kids get there, say hi to my pal Willie," Sammy said, "and Ethel, and Gino and Paula, too." "We will," I said, even though I had no idea who any of those people were. All I knew was that we had to get moving fast. Luna said a quick goodbye, and we caught the next train. After 4 stops, we got off and rushed up the stairs to the street. It was dark, but I could see that the sign said Delancey Street. "I'm not the best reader in the world," I said, "but that doesn't look like it says Essex Street to me." Sammy says you walk down Delancey past Willie's kitchen and poof, you're on Essex. We walked really fast. The lights from the window of the buildings cast weird shadows on the sidewalks. "These are not zombies, Tiger," I said to myself. I admit it. I said it more than once. I might have even said it at least 6 times. Okay, it was 8 to be exact.
Suddenly, I saw a human-shaped shadow lurch out of a doorway and move toward us. Help! I screamed. I was so scared. I must have jumped 5 feet in the air. Don't be afraid, kid. It's just me, Willie. Willie, Luna said, are you Sammy Sampson's friend?
Yep, Sammy and me were thick as mud, two peas in a pod.
He's my friend, too, Luna told him. How about if I fry you kids up a couple burgers? Willie offered. Any friend of Sammy's is a friend of mine.
Thanks, Willie, but we're in a huge hurry.
How about some hot dogs? Willie asked, and before we could answer, he called to a man pushing a cart.
Hey, Gino, he shouted, you got any red hot dogs and cold drinks left in there?
Coming right up, Gino answered.
That's really nice of you, Gino, but we don't have time to eat, I said.
Take 'em to go, kids, live it up, Gino said, handing us our food.
Great idea, Luna said. Let's put them in the snack and scoot. I'll bring them to the fiesta.
Turning to Willie, she explained, my dad's in the army and he's coming home on leave tonight and we're giving him a party.
A woman in a puffy green coat hurried over, pushing another cart. We love our soldiers, she said. How about I send them some hot pretzels? Extra mustard, no charge.
That's my Ethel, Gino said. And I'll go inside and get Paula to throw in some pickles, too. Dill and half sour.
Before you could say Sammy Sampson and his singing saw, the cooler on my snack and scoot was full of New York treats for us to take home. That was the good news. The bad news was we had to run the rest of the block to Essex Street, dragging the snack and scoot behind us. It was much heavier now that it was loaded with food. I made a mental note to do something about that when I got home. An inventor's work is never done. At the corner of Essex and Delancey, we saw a Chinese restaurant. Next to it was a small bakery.
That's the building, I said. Let's go find David.
Tiger, do you really think we have enough time to find him and get back to the diner? Luna asked.
Sure, I said. No problem.
But we both knew that wasn't true. The clock was ticking, and we were running out of time.